go out to LA. New anthem. Love part two.
What?
To live in LA. West side. West side. West side. To live and die in L.A., where everybody try to fatten they pocket. So many hustle for the cash, so it's hard to knock it. Everybody got their own thing, currency chasing worldwide through the hard times.
Well, hello, hello, hello. God bless you, community family, and welcome to Gang Talk with Sister Herron and Skipp Townsend. You know, we've been doing this work on air, online, on the radio for 6 years, and just a change in that format last year in September put us online now. So we're very happy to be with the Morris Media family, and very happy to share this hour with our community, because you know, if you've been following Gang Talk, it's a critical issue, and we need to discuss it. We really need to discuss it. We have to open doors and make a way for our children to feel like they have a right to live and survive in the Los Angeles community. So we share that concern. Everybody here at the table, even our guest, bless his heart, Marcus Woods, has come back to join us because he wants to be a participant. So we're here collecting those that want to be receive redemption and receive a new way, a different path from the one that took them away from us in the first place. So God bless you once again, and welcome to this very important hour to our community in South Los Angeles, and really remarkably important to the city of Chicago, important to the city of Memphis, important to the city of Philadelphia, any place where our children are being murdered in the name of gang violence. We want to reach out and embrace them as well. So, Skipp, God bless you. Thank you for being our co-host. We so respect who you are, what God has done for you, and what you're doing for us.
Well, thank you, Sister Herron. As always, I give honor and praise to God. I'm truly grateful just to be alive, to be able to share this moment with you this evening. And grateful, too, for the Brother Marcus, you know, see his steadfast commitment, not only here, but at Ceasefire. And we need the next generation of individuals, you know, to step up, and he's definitely doing that. So I'm truly grateful. Also for last week's guest, too. I'm grateful for him.
Yes, Stinson Brown. Yes. We really want to thank Stinson for the courage, and I'm going to say courage because he is a uniform officer with the Los Angeles Police Department, and historically, we have not had good relationships.
Right.
We have just not. Historically, in this city, in this community, our relationship with that agency has been poor. So through the hard work of Ceasefire and the Watch Gang Task Force, we've changed that in our community, not for the whole city, just for the South Bureau community, in that the most powerful thing that we accomplished was to get them to stop shooting us.
Yes, indeed.
That was indeed the most critical thing that we had to push on them. Don't just shoot our people. Do not shoot our family members that have mental challenges.
Right.
Okay, so that's what makes it difficult for us to have those conversations with Stinson, because he's on their side of the table and our side as well.
Yes, indeed. He is the father of a homicide victim.
That's right.
His son
was
killed, his only son, yes. Mm-hmm. And he makes a point to say his only son. I'm truly grateful that he has not given up on the community, and he is actually investing in the community.
Yes.
Even though he said he's going to leave the community in another year or so, he's retiring, but
we're not going to let him go.
Right, can't do it.
But, you know, the division does have a habit of swapping officers out after like a 3-year period, and then they change them, send them somewhere else. We get a new officer that we have to start all over.
But, you know, it's like a good mechanic. You know, I don't know if you guys ever had the experience I've had, but I've had poor cars. So I need that honest mechanic that's going to tell me the truth not just play me and take my money.
That's right.
Well, that's what I see in LAPD, is we need those honest officers, those officers who aren't going to play us, who are going to give us up front what we need and be that liaison between law enforcement and the community. So it's hard to replace them. You know, it's, you know, if we have to go through two or three and say, nah, that's not the right fit. That's not the right fit
Look
to find
someone.
Look how
long it took us to find somebody to step into Kenny Garner's shoes.
Right.
Kenny Garner, our beloved police chief that passed away too soon.
Yes.
And in a moment, in a blink, he was gone. And so we didn't have a chance to prepare for his absence. We didn't have a chance to prepare for who was coming behind him. So when Kenny passed on, we had to kind of start all over from scratch.
Right.
Okay, but we did. Our perseverance, our insistence,
right.
And at the point where we had to start asking them, yes, you have the license to kill, but was that murder necessary? Mm-hmm. We had to ask them that way. Yes, you have the law and the authority to kill, but was that necessary? And those were questions they couldn't answer.
Mm. Right.
Those were questions they could not answer. So, Skip, we have several guests here tonight, important things to talk about. But I did say that I wanted to give you a few minutes to cover the trip that victims went on this past weekend up to Sacramento.
Right. So let's just take care of that word victims. More victims. Those are survivors. So Survivor Speak Conference actually happened again. I believe this is the fourth year of the existence of the Survivor Speaks Conference. One of the key instrumental people who brought this to the South LA community, Akilah Sherrells, actually reached out about 3 or 4 years ago and told me what was going on. And of course, Vicky, Adela, and other people who were involved, and Laura, and other Southern California Ceasefire Committee, YJC. And they connected with people that used to be just in the state of California, people from Oakland, Fresno. And the purpose of this, and now it's countrywide, people were there from Ohio and Texas as well. But the purpose is because there are so many legislations that give money to the victims of violent crimes, and those victims turn around and support suppression. They support harsher sentences.
Right.
They support changing the laws, like three strikes and things of that nature, where they will take the children from our community and put them away forever.
Right.
So the idea as a survivor speaks is to come in and talk about the healing process. We don't heal because of that. So we're traumatized, and then when our children are gone forever, we're traumatized again.
That's right.
So we're victimized by the same system that is supposed to be there to support us. So the Survivor Speak Conference actually talks about, how does the healing start? How do we deal with trauma without throwing our communities away and throwing away our children?
Right.
And it starts with us talking about prevention, intervention, education, you know, small pieces of suppression when it's needed, but actually having an open dialogue with each other on the healing process. And sometimes, even though the governor was there and he spoke, even though in years before we've had a lieutenant governor, very powerful man, used to be the mayor of San Francisco, Gavin.
Newsom,
right. Very powerful speakers and people who support. However, sometimes it's just about us getting together to heal with other people who have similar experiences from around the country. So it was a very beautiful event. As always, LA showed out. We were there. Probably, I want to say, about at least 200 people from L.A.
That's good. So, well, see, because, you know, the truth is the Crips and Bloods were born in this city. They were not only made in America, they were created in Los Angeles. And any city in the country that claims Crips, claims Bloods, originated from us. Somebody gave them that notion that this was okay to do. So it is appropriate for California, Los Angeles victims to show up and say that they were harmed. It's perfectly okay. We're proud of those that went because, as you said last week, Skip, when we talk about families and victims that have been murdered, that's the hardest subject for us, and we want to lead the conversation.
Right.
We really want to lead. Well, because it's
definitely
it's hurtful.
Yes.
It's hurtful and it's painful, and our community has to wake up because you don't want to have your child be the next sacrifice to this madness.
Right.
And that's the truth that brings us here every Thursday. That's
yes.
the truth. Okay.
You're absolutely right.
All right. Well, thank you for that update because it is important to share how we're going about this healing, how we're going about the recovery and the reclaiming in our own people in the Black nation. And that it is a national issue.
Yes.
National issue. So LA is just trying to reach out to our communities and let them know that we have outstanding people in here working to turn things around. So we're going to start with our introductions. introduce this young man first. You introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your background, what brought you here, as much as you're comfortable in telling us.
All right. Well, hello, everyone. Praise God. I'm thankful, very thankful for being here. Of course, I thank you for the opportunity to share. You know, my name is Gilbert Johnson, and I'm a justice and safety organizer with Community Coalition. I'm a resident and native of South LA, being here my whole life, you know, 32 years of age. You know, graduate of Crenshaw High School, Shaw Dog. Lived it in. I got to represent, you know, a little
you
bit, just a little
all
bit.
All the schools in our neighborhood. Look, Jordan Bulldogs, come on.
Hey, it's all love though. You know,
yes, it is. Love. Yes, it is.
You know, just lived it and seen it and done it. Did time locked up and got into drugs and different activities that I shouldn't have been involved in. For a long period of my life, started getting in trouble at an early age.
Ow.
And I first got kicked out of school on the west side at Lasis at 15. And then I got sent to my home school at Crenshaw, which just put me in my element because I grew up in Hyde Park. So they just sent me home, and that just took off in a whole nother direction.
In the environment.
Right. Led me down a long path of, you know, just getting in trouble, drugs and abuse, harming myself, harming others. But, you know, thank God for, you know, redemption and second chances, and the chance to make a difference and want to give back and want to be the change that I know our communities need. And, you know, now I'm a father, I'm a minister, I'm a husband, you know, father of three baby boys. So my heart is invested into this work and into our communities because I want a better future for my sons. I have a 1-year-old, a 3-year-old, and a 5-year-old. And they're young black men, you know, the circumstances we had to come up in and live in and live through and the resiliency that we build up is profound.
Yes. You know, the beauty about it is God's not only brought you back, but he's given you the charge as three young male lives that you're going to raise away from the nightmare that overtook you, that overtook you. Our next guest, sir.
Hello. My name is Chase Fredrick. I am the executive vice president of Los Angeles Southwest College's Associated Student Organization. I'm, again, thankful for the opportunity to speak to you guys here tonight. Or this evening. A little bit of background about me. Grew up in the 90s, had a lot of family in Los Angeles, a lot in Vegas, and switching in between both homes in both areas, I saw a lot of different gang violence and activity. The people I looked up to, my cousins at the time, because I grew up without brothers, all sisters, they themselves were involved in gang activity. Yeah, I would know my cousins.
Your cousins, okay.
So I looked up to them, and as I grew up, I saw what they were doing, and I thought, you know, as any young impressionable kid, this is what I want to do. But it was because my older cousins saw that this wasn't exactly for me, because unfortunately, you know, circumstances in their lives led them down that path, and they didn't want the same for me. So it's thanks to their efforts, I didn't go down that same trail. And now at the age of 23, I'm in college. I'm able to invest in my own future, and I want to help people invest in theirs. And I can do that, you know, without being on the college campus. And I can do that by reaching out to any brother, any sister out there who may find themselves going down the path that my cousins averted me from going down, and helping them get on the path that they truly want, that's really meant for them and their families.
Right. And then.
Oh, good evening. Thank you, Sister Herron. Good evening. My name is Winnetka Vaden. First, I want to give an honor to God, and I want to thank both Sister Herron and Skipp Townsend for allowing us to come on their talk show and to share a little bit about myself. I'm 53 years old. I have 4 children. I have 8 brothers, and my lifestyle started at a very young age when gangbanging first started. The majority of my brothers was into the West Side, when back in the day, gangbanging was all good. Gangbanging was fun. It got to the point where while they was gangbanging, I had no other leadership because my brothers was deep into gang.
They were your leadership.
Yes, and so they were my followers, but at a young age, at the age of 13, I became involved in and out of the streets, runaway. My juvenile record started at Bret Hart. For having a gun at 13, so I've been in the system at the age of 13. I spent 17 years in and out of prison. I've been homeless. I've been in the drug game, the street game, the drug style, the lifestyle. Right now, I've been home from prison for 4 years, and I wanted to find out what could I do to give back to our community, to let these kids know that they have an opportunity to have a second chance in life, to be able to know that they have people that would take the time to give them incentive and motives, and the love that to show them that they, if I can change and make a difference, that someone else can make a difference in life. So I got together with Community Coalition, Gilbert, and we worked together to deal with Prop 47. And me and him have been collaborating ever since the law was passed. And right now we are trying to open the doors that address homelessness and Prop 47.
All right.
My name is Adewole Umoja. I'm Dr. Adewole Umoja. I'm an adjunct professor of political science and history at Los Angeles Southwest College. I was born in Los Angeles 69 years ago. I went to school here. I have been deeply involved in the black liberation struggle in this area since the 1960s. I've also been involved in other areas of the United States as well as outside of the United States. I think that what we're discussing, Prop 47, the criminalization of black youth, is symptomatic of the institutional oppression that we have to overcome.
Yes.
Okay, the efforts at rehabilitating gang members, giving them a new perspective so that they can utilize their creativity and their intellect to benefit black people, as opposed to being sidetracked, as so many oppressed people are. Because I want to make it clear, black people don't have a genetic predisposition to antisocial behavior. Much of what we see occurs in other nations to people who are oppressed. So it is our role to try to get the skills and the tools necessary so that we can improve the quality of our lives.
You know, everything you said is true. The problem is, when they dropped those drugs on us, we became our own oppressors. Our kids became their own enemy. Our communities turned on each other, as if we had a right to do that. See, and for me, there's a lot of bitterness in my age group that says to me, what's wrong with these young people? Why don't they get it? Why don't they get it together? Why don't they fix what's broken in them? And at the same time, my age group doesn't realize we were a partner in their nightmare, in creating it for them, in helping them loose themselves in our community to create these many black cartels in Los Angeles. See, because the Crips and Bloods were driven by, they didn't start out that way. The Crips did not start out that way. They started out as community protection, actually, against the Klan
right.
in the Jordan Downs Watts community.
Hmm? They were the spook hunters.
Spook hunters, right, yes. Right. Spook well, hunters. I know they had names. I just, right. you know, but that's originally what brought about the baby Cribs. Now, when the dress came, they turned into the Crips, okay? Right. But originally, the idea was to protect the community. Once the drugs came in, it just changed the whole dynamic.
Well, okay. Sister, oh, go ahead, sir. Go ahead. Sorry.
Well, I just want to say, first of all, the drugs didn't just come in.
No, they did not.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Right. You know, systematic mechanisms for oppression.
As far back as Richard Nixon's administration.
Before then.
Yeah, right.
Even before then. Second World War. This, what was the OSS became the CIA. They have been instrumental in the transportation of drugs.
Right.
In the Vietnam conflict, similarly.
Yes.
And the distribution of drugs targeted at our community was an undercover device to fund reactionaries in Nicaragua.
Well, they're now coming. It's now coming to the forefront that it was by design.
Well, listen.
Okay.
Well,
Skip.
One of the things. One of the things, and both of you guys are hitting it right on the head, is that prior to the generation that I'm a part of, it didn't work. It didn't work. Prior to my generation, your generation, you have a resilience where it didn't work.
Right.
The Ku Klux Klan, the burning of the crosses, all the things that happened in the down south, all these things, people band together, came together. I don't want to just say Martin Luther King Jr. I want to say Harry Belafonte, the freedom singers, the freedom writers. Mm-hmm. People band together. You know, it makes me cry thinking about these guys went on tour and got money together to buy cars for other people to go and help them register to vote.
Mm-hmm.
So the way that your generation and before came together to help each other, no matter what they put on you and those before you, it didn't work.
That's right.
It didn't work till it got to us.
It was a building generation.
But listen, it worked when it got to us.
Well,
with
see,
the
because
Crips,
we
the Bloods, the drugs, the guns, we said, forget everything you guys went through.
Mm-hmm.
Forget everything you want to teach us. We gonna buy into this system here.
Well, because those drugs took us away from you. They took us away from you. They took the mothers out of the home, the fathers already out.
Right.
You know what I mean? The last harm was when it attacked the mother.
Exactly.
Holding down the home for the kids.
Well, it took
when she became
first.
The father was maybe not. Okay,
and the father gotta be the head.
We're
always.
Not
never the
look,
tail.
We're going to talk about the welfare and what welfare did to the fathers of our home.
Said farewell to the fathers.
Said farewell. Yes, it sure did. And we're going to talk about that, but we're not going to talk about welfare tonight because we got a lot of stuff to cover.
Right.
Now, we're just trying to lay the path of how we got here.
Yes,
and we're not going to be in denial about that.
Right.
That, yes, it was a trick. Yes, the crack dropped on us. We wasn't expecting it. We didn't know. In California, L.A., by Harlem standards, we were very virgins.
Right.
Whereas in the Nixon administration, heroin was all over Harlem.
Right.
Okay.
Remember the movie Cotton Comes to Harlem?
Okay.
There's a message in that movie.
Okay. But
Cotton Comes to Harlem.
There's a message about the heroin addiction, the drug addiction that's been targeted towards the black community.
Right.
So we're here to talk about Prop 47 and how to get out of that. We want our kids that are, and I want you to be clear about this. Because some people are afraid 47 is going to just open the floodgates and let all the hoodlums out.
They don't have the information that these individuals have because they think they're violent offenders and they're going to come home and they're actually saying, as a matter of fact, the president of the police union, he's saying this right now that you have to stop Prop 47, AB 109, SB 260, SB 261, saying you got to stop it because it's going to bring all these killers home. So I'm happy you guys are here to
nullify it. Want to get rid of that president of the police union, so that's our give back to him. And that we really want to get rid of you, sir.
Right.
We don't respect you. We don't value anything you say to our community, so you can be quiet or go away.
Yeah, he said that Ezell Ford lived in a gang infested community. Wow.
I live in a gang infested community. Okay.
Right.
I've seen murder. Okay.
Right.
So does that mean they get to shoot me like they killed Ezell? Let's move on to the 47 because we got guests that came here to talk about that.
Right.
You know, Skip,
I'm sorry, I get
some things are real sensitive for me.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so let's talk about Props 47.
The facts about it.
Yes.
Right. So, right away, let's dispel that myth that we're letting out hardened criminals, murderers, rapists, because Prop 47 is aimed at giving low-level, nonviolent offenders a second chance at life. So we're talking about petty theft under $950, shoplifting under $950, simple drug possession, crimes that are considered wobblers. And what a wobbler is, or what that means, is that at the judge's discretion, he can give you a felony or a misdemeanor for these charges. Prop 47 turned all of those charges to misdemeanors. And what we saw historically is that black folks and brown folks ended up getting the felonies. We got the harsher sentences at the judge's discretion, right? So we made up the prison population. We blew it up, right? And now folks were making billions and billions of dollars off the backs of our labor, this cheap slave labor. But so it made those felonies misdemeanors. And so it was also retroactive. So it's a very true fact that we have about 16,000 folks statewide, because this is a California-wide initiative, that have gotten out of prison and local county jails statewide. So folks are coming home. Folks are being reconnected with their families. And they're now given the opportunity to reduce those felonies to misdemeanors and then get those misdemeanors expunged from their records, which pretty much takes off the barriers to getting a better job, you know, to getting certain business licenses, right, to getting financial aid and housing assistance, right? We have folks coming home and getting their daughters back and getting their families back that were taken because of this harsh system that has really oppressed our communities for years and years. The whole war on drugs, you were talking about it, you touched on it, but Prop 47 is aiming to change how we look at public safety. And it's redirecting millions of dollars. Right now we're fighting for millions of dollars, $150 million to come back into our communities to support gang intervention, to support drug rehabilitation, mental to support health. More
gonna
mental
get to
health.
All that. We're going to get to the funding later because, you know, funding for all of us has been invisible.
Thank you.
Non-available. And I really want to get all of our guests in this conversation because each one has a unique perspective about this. So
I would like to kind of bring things within perspective, right? So right now we're at Prop 47. We're looking at the state of the black community and the minority community. But we got that way through history. And so it brings me back to a book I read, which is Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome. And so what ultimately says is, you know, we were slaves and we went from that to being, you know, separate but equal, discrimination, so on and so forth. And at no point in that time period did our community get the chance to heal, the healing that it needed. And so we were talking earlier about, you know, resilience to the issue, people banding together. Well, after 500-600 years of just constant battering, you know, that resilience, no matter how strong it is, wears away. And so we find ourselves where we are now, at Prop 47, trying to beginning to make the steps to be able to systematically reverse what has been done to our people.
Right.
You know, we're tired and fatigued, and this is a chance to bring our brothers, our sisters, our mothers and fathers home so we can get that healing experience we need. And people are trying to characterize Prop 47 as, like, you know, we're trying to bring back rapists and killers and things of this nature. But that really isn't the case. We're trying to bring back the youth and the people who were possibly in unfortunate situations, who made a choice that had, 'cause one reason or another, and then now we find, you know, you're in jail because, you know, the judge don't look like you.
Well, let's put it this way. There were years when the police treated this with full suppression. And their answer was, well, we're going to just arrest our way out of this, arrest our way through it. So we've had abuse with the gang injunctions. We've had over-criminalization for personal issues that are just don't rise to the level of assault and battery and homicide, okay? So anything like, was that you that said under $1,000, we have been put in prison with a potential for third strikes and all kinds of foolishness that the suppression brought about trying to contain the nightmare. It didn't work. Right. It still hasn't worked. And so now we have the overcrowding, which forced, and I'm happy, forced Prop 47 so there could be some adjustments in the wrongdoing. Right. Okay, wrongdoing in the courts, in the right. Sentencing process, wrongdoing and judges we talked about that have been paid people in privatized prisons.
Well, Sister Herron, the question is now with this information and this great panel of experts, what do we do? What can we get the community to do at this point? Either one of you two, what can we get now?
You know, right now, this is where my interest was. Being that I've had several felonies been in and out of prison, and like I said, Prop 47, it makes a difference in reducing your felonies for those that may have problems getting their kids in child custody, the kids that may be in the system, mm-hmm. looking for a job, certain classes you might want to take at school. If you don't want to do nothing but go and get on general leave, at least you have the doors open where if you get your felony reduced, you have opportunity to get here, get on some kind of assistance, and let them open the doors for the training facilities and everything else that this money will be facilitated and used for. So what our system is, our strategy is to let people know they have a second chance in life,
right.
Bring awareness, and this is what we're doing. We've been hosting several events at Southwest College. We came together and put together our own format as to how we was going to address the issues. And first we wanted to give and make sure we brought awareness to our community. So what we're doing now is bringing awareness to our youth.
Well, let me, it's break time. Okay, that went real fast. Mm-hmm.
But when it's break, just finish your sentence, though. Don't just stop.
Oh yeah. So we want to. So what? Like I said, we know right now that time is an essence. And so we're making sure that we want to make everybody aware of what Prop 47 holds entail and the opportunity of getting their records reduced and having a second chance in life to be a productive citizen for things that they suspect us to not be able to challenge.
That's right.
They are like obstacles.
That's right. Thank you. When we come back, we're going to pick that up because there needs to be clarification for the felonies and the lesser charges, because a lot of folks with felonies don't believe that they're going to be able to get anything
right.
out of this. So we want to clarify that.
You got proof right here.
Right. Okay.
I got one drop.
We'll talk
down
about it after.
Three more.
After break, okay? That's important information. Well, God bless you. We're back from that break, and we're trying to make those break times a little shorter because we don't want to lose our train of thought. So, Winnetka, we're going to yield to our professor here for a brief comment, and then we're going to go into that felony. That felony.
So the question was, Professor, what are some of the things that we want our audience to do? How can they get involved? Because you guys got great information. So what is going on where they want to get involved? Where do they need to come? Where is that expungement? What can we expect from the community for support?
Okay, well, in the very near future, April 21st at 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. at Los Angeles Southwest College, we're having a forum where you have representatives, elected representatives, and their designated representatives coming together to address the issue of homelessness. Okay. Also, we will be providing opportunities for sign-ups so that we can engage those who need relief from Prop 47. About a year ago on the campus of Southwest College, in conjunction with Winnetka, Vaden, and Coco, we presented sessions where we had persons in need of reductions come. We had lawyers there so that they can get the relief needed. Mm-hmm. Now, we will probably repeat that. But the dealing with homelessness, dealing with Prop 47, these are aspects of a large problem.
Right.
And I use an example like we're making a cake.
Right.
Okay. When you make a cake, you may have sugar, a necessary ingredient, but you cannot make a cake with sugar alone.
Right.
You have to have all of the appropriate ingredients. You have to be able to put those ingredients in the appropriate environment to get the desired result. So what we are doing is we're taking elements of this larger problem. We're mm-hmm. trying to address them, put them together, having a strategic vision so that we can really begin to engage in remediation, not temporary, but permanent structural change for people in need.
Right. You know, that brings up a very important concern, see, because people assume that you get the early release, you're going to come back and just pick up kind of where you left off. Go home to mom, go back to your neighborhood, get yourself an apartment. It doesn't work like that.
Right.
It doesn't work like that. So we wanted to talk about the felony aspect that Prop 47 does cover, because we have a lot of ex-felons, like you said. What did you call them? Where the judge decides if it's going to be a
wobbler.
There it is. Talk about the felonies, Gilbert. Start.
Well, like I mentioned, I myself had one of my felonies reduced under Prop 47. And I remember the last time I got out was in 2009. And I couldn't get a job at the 99-cent store. They wouldn't hire me. Walmart wouldn't hire me. Target wouldn't hire me. And I ended up finding odd jobs here and there. And I was presented with the opportunity to work at Community Coalition because they believe in that redemption. They believe in second chances. But those felonies hinder you from so much opportunity and, you know, so many ways you can progress in life. I don't know if, Nikki, you want to talk about your felonies and everything that's going on. How felony has really barred. It's like you almost get barred from society when you get those felonies.
It turns into a life sentence.
You know, right? And it's setting you up for failure. Because what do they expect you to do when you get out and you can't get a job? I'm going to go back to what I know how to do. I'm going to go back to grinding. I'm going to go back to hitting licks, passing, because I can't do anything else, even if I wanted to. So,
you know, with my felonies, they became very hindrance with me. When I started off, when I first came home from prison in 2001, I started off taking law at Southwest College. So once I finished taking the two classes that was necessary for me to pursue in my prerequisites to continue law, I was hindered because of my felonies. So, like I said, with me addressing the issues of reducing my felonies, I find that right now, with me having three of my felonies reduced, I'm able to pursue. I'm getting ready to graduate from Southwest College June the 2nd. I will be able to go to Cal State University or another university, and I'm able to take the classes and what I really want to pursue in life. You know, when I started school and found that I wasn't able to take what I wanted, I was just there since 2001 taking what they wanted me to take just to satisfy them. I wasn't able to satisfy myself.
Right. Okay?
And then when it came to me addressing the situation, my biggest fight now with me dealing with my felonies being reduced is my kids. My grandbabies are in the system, and by me being a grandparent, I want to spend time with my grandkids. I have to go through so many changes to be able to be in compliance with what the system wants when all I have is a felony that can be reduced. So I am addressing these issues because, like I said, with social services, it's a big problem. And right now, if anything, it's not about the money. It's not anything that revolves around Prop 47 for me, but the fact that I know I have a chance to see my grandbabies and have a say-so in my grandbabies' life. Okay, when it comes to jobs, yes, I've worked in the post office and everything. I have my own business right now, an apprenticeship, beauty salon. But still, I found that if with my felonies reduced, I can challenge any obstacles out there in life as far as a job and obtaining the type of job.
That's really why I wanted to speak about this, because there are a lot of ex-felons out here that have been home for years, that have done no harm, that have lived decent lives, but they can't get out of that quicksand. You know, it just seems to hold them. And my sad understanding, okay, is that parole is a choke chain. Right. They put that choke chain around your neck like you some kind of animal, and they pull it when they get ready. See, so if you look at them funny, they're going to put you back in a cell. You see, so when you're on parole and probation, those turn into lifetimes, as you said very seriously. Right. Can't get employment, can't take certain classes, a lot of things that you're prevented from doing. Right. Voting is another big issue. Right. So we really want to be, there are jobs now that are felon friendly,
right. Right.
So you can be re-entered into mainstream. And that's really the kind of doors that you're opening, is right. trying to have a place when they get out on the early release, they can come and get real conversation about what the next step is. That's how we do that full circle the professor was talking about.
Yeah, you know, that's a process. I'm sorry to cut you off, but that's a process. Teaching people the process. A lot of people don't understand the process of coming home
right.
and what's available, what's not available. So that's why I say information is the key, because a lot of people say, well, they won't hire me. Something right. that Nikki said, though, was about having that beauty shop, having that being an entrepreneur, having right. her own business. So for me, that was key when I came home. I came home in 88, so 1988. So when I came home, I went through the same thing, but I got a tow truck. And I started towing, and I bought another truck and another truck. And I named the tow truck company Level 1 Tow Service because I don't care if I was level 4, level 3, level 2, or level 1 in prison. They wasn't going to give me a job, even though my crime, there was no Prop 47. So I started Level 1 Tow Service, which I had to feed myself. And that's something else I would like to, I'm glad you guys are bringing up, because that's something we need to teach each other, is how can we feed ourselves legally with a print shop, with doing T-shirts, or whatever it is we have to do to find a way to provide for our family, something legal that we can be proud of, and tell our children, I'm going to work, come with me, that trade, that skill.
Well, that's a whole different conversation, Skip. And we're going to talk about that, because employment is important. But we're here to talk about Prop 47, the specifics of it, the advantages. Are there any limitations that we need to share? You know, what does it take to have Prop 47 work for you? I think that's really what I'm trying to, the question I'm
trying to get at. It takes ambition, it takes will, and it takes to have somebody sitting down there giving you the tools, taking the time to go with you over the paperwork. Mm-hmm. You know, it takes you to go down and get you a live scan to obtain your rap sheet. Once you got your rap sheet tells you basically where your case was committed, your crime, and what type of felonies qualified to be reduced. Once you get your rap sheet and go over the cases that are reducible, then you have somebody fill out the petition. The petition is no more than 5 questions that they ask you that are addressed. Once you fill out your petition, then you send it to the court or the county where your case may have occurred at, and once it gets to the judge will either honor it or dishonor it. And he has no reason not to honor it, because if you qualify under Prop 47, under the certain terms, as Gilbert mentioned, for forgery, receiving stolen goods, cannabis possession, and anything that's qualifying under Prop 47, you shouldn't have a problem getting reduced, your record reduced. Once you fill out the petition, it shouldn't take no more than 30 to 90 days to get a response. And what is important right now is that we have a window period that's getting ready to end until we pursue to have the extension. We need to make sure that we let our people know that they have an opportunity to go in here and get their records reduced. And that's why we are making sure that we bring awareness that within this time frame that we have left, come out and let us teach you about Prop 47. Mm-hmm. And you'd be amazed that some people think they don't qualify because of this. Right. No, come out and find out for yourself, because I know if I can do it, you can do it. Let us come out here and show you, give you awareness, tutors, and fill out your petitions and get your records reduced. And like I said, make a difference, because getting your records reduced makes a big difference. Believe me, it makes a big difference. And then not only that, we want to address to make sure once these people are released from maybe prison or whatever else, if they do get released, because you can't get released from prison under Prop 47, you know, resentence and everything, then we need to prepare, you know, a strategy as far as when they come home. We have to still deal with the fact that these people are going to be homeless, don't have jobs and everything. So we need to have a statistic plan set up to be able to address these people and get them back into society. Right. Because it don't take long to get you back in society, long as we know that we have somebody to take the time to focus on addressing their needs.
Absolutely. It's a full round thing. And we can't just release them and put them back out on the street, put them back in their neighborhood with empty hands.
But one thing
we just can't do that. We kind of have to guide them and lead them to recovery. And I'm just going to say this personally. You need to start before they're released. Really, really. Right. Get in their ear before they hit the street.
Right. So.
And get an idea where they're going. Because, look, mm-hmm. I'm going to be really practical about this. Everybody coming out don't want to see us. Not everybody. The majority do, but not everybody. And so we have to be prepared for that. And to ask them to come home and have nothing for them, it makes us look like we're wasting the time of those trying to help us.
Well, see, yeah. now you're getting to the moment that we're in right now, where I mentioned earlier, fighting for this money, right? Because Prop 47 is, again, it's about second chances, but it's also about reshaping how we look at public safety. So for decades, you think of public safety, you think of law enforcement. Let's call the police. Well, no, we're taking another approach and saying, call the first responders, call the interventionists in the area, right? Call folks that can actually come and mediate and stop retaliation and can have an impact on that. But we know that there is a lack of funding, like you mentioned earlier. So right now we're organizing and fighting with the governor to increase the funding and get him to maximize the savings under Prop 47 to $150 million. Because, again, that money is going to come to communities that have the highest need. That's another fight we're going to take on. But it's going to come down and go to there's three buckets. There's mental health and drug rehabilitation. There's K through 12 education and dropout prevention, which we're going to fight for our interventionists to set up, safe passages, to set up youth centers, youth development. I mean, it's a lot we can do with this money because the legislation is written loosely. And then the other part is the victims and the trauma services and the healing that we were talking about earlier. So right now, we either have $29.3 million or $150 million, and we're fighting for the bigger
keep
chunk,
fighting,
right? Because, I mean, and it's going to take people power to help.
That's really what I was asking. Yeah. What do the people need to do?
They need to show up and shout out and act up and whatever they have to do. See, what we're not understanding collectively, the only one missing in our equation is us.
Thank you.
Okay, we're sitting at home waiting for somebody else to fix this when really it's up to each one of us to get involved. These are our children. These are our children, okay, that have been abused by this whole nightmare, and now they're paying the ultimate price for it, either with their lives or the prison choke chain that keeps them forever. And we have to break that cycle. So this is why our guests are here tonight.
They need to give addresses. Go ahead, Doctor. I saw Doctor was going to say something.
Well, I just want to reaffirm what Gilbert is saying. You know, the issue is this. You've heard the old saying that put your money where your mouth is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Budget allocation in the state is really an example of what you believe in and the extent to which you believe it.
Right.
You believe it to the point that you are willing to put money, resources behind it to make things happen. Now, it's proven, it is known that mental health services, housing services, rehab services, they work,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Right.
They work and they can have a lasting effect. See, we have to understand that it's not simply this generation because they influence coming generation
right,
who in turn influences others. This is like what we call the intergenerational impact of public policy. Laws that are passed don't just affect us right now. They set the table mm-hmm. for the future. So as Gilbert was saying, one, we have to expand our understanding of what it is to be human in this society. What are the essentials that all human beings should have? And put the resources needed to accomplish it.
Thank you.
Well, you know what? We're all in agreement about that. The problem in our community, we're the only ones in agreement about that. You know, you got to go to Sacramento, pound on their desk, get in their face, holler and shout at the fools sometimes to make them understand we're serious about this. Now, when you don't have that coalition of motivated spirits to go after it like that, we don't get anything in return. You see, so my whole thing, we are a black nation in this nation. And it's time for us to wake up and start taking care of ourselves. It's really incumbent upon us, Professor, to take care of ourselves. And they're the proof. They're the proof.
Okay.
They're the proof of what the work we need to be doing, the work we collectively need to be doing. And Skip and I talk about the apathy among our own that's become part of the problem. You see, the resources you're talking about, the apathy should be helping us get that. But they're sitting waiting for you to do it, waiting for you to do it, waiting for you to make it happen. And so this is kind of like a slap in our face to wake us up, to respect the fact that we have work to do. We have work to do. And see, Winnetka's out here, Gilbert's out here, trying to shout it from the rooftops to tell you to come this way, because we have a way for you.
Yes. Sister, before you finish, I just want to say, because you're talking about the people who are out there, but I also want to give a shout out to Southwest College.
Yes.
Being here today, a professor and a young student, but during the time of 100 days and 100 nights, when there was a fear in the community, the fear wasn't, for me, it wasn't real. It was just saying. It was only 4 homicides during that time period. But what Southwest College did was open its doors and told people, hey, look, if you have a fear, allow your children or yourself to come here, and you can get a ride from here. Yeah. They'll provide food and stuff for the children. The young people can use computers, get help with homework. That's what a community does during a time of need. So having, I'm not going to say representatives of Southwest College, but a doctor from Southwest College, I definitely want to, you know, be clear that he did not identify himself as the representative. But I want to say that I'm truly grateful that Southwest College does what it does.
Yes.
And we have people who come from there who are representing today.
Southwest and made amazing progress.
Mr. Danny Cabot would have been here because he's a part of everything we have close together.
So Danny Tabor tried when I was like 13 to talk to me, and I was like, man, who is this dude? I
had
community service in Inglewood, and he's at the YMCA, so tell him Skip's not running it
anymore. Okay.
We can talk now.
But one thing I wanted to address, like you said, what can we do to resolve the problems? Like I said, right now, Community Coalition is hosting a variety of awareness, trying to get our young people aware of what we need to do to go and fight legislators, politics, train them, training facilities or whatever. We all need to give awareness. You know, we have websites and numbers that they can call us and contact us and ask us about the town hall meetings that we're giving, that the meetings that Community Coalition giving, you know, because we need to continue to fight for what we know that we deserve and what we put into this effort to make Prop 47 successful. And we have town hall meetings.
Absolutely. This is a new wave. This is a part of the movement that's coming to us. It's about time. It's overdue. And it's up to us to open that door.
Right.
Really. We've been sitting around waiting for LAPD, sheriff, somebody else to fix this. I'm just going to say they tried in the only way they know how, but it didn't include me.
Right. We have to get together and fight the power.
There it is.
Yeah.
You know, the Isley brothers taught us that years ago. And I was too young to understand what it meant, but they said fight the power. Before Flavor Flav and Chuck D said it, the Isley brothers said it. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't get it.
Yeah, we have to fight the power. Because other than that, we've missed the 5 small prints of where we at, okay? And if we don't pay attention and fight it, we're going to be...
It's going to roll over us like it already has. Mm-hmm. You know, this president, bless his heart, he wasn't able to do a lot, and certainly not a lot of overt things for us, but he did have his attorney general look into the sentencing and the injustice in the sentencing. So he did push that door open, and it gave a place for props like 47. You know, he has a Brother's Keeper program that should help us with the reentry because, as you said, very telling. There's the issue of homelessness.
Right.
Homelessness. Oh, so we're going to bring them out of prison, expunge their record, and let them sleep on the bus bench. Is that the plan?
Really? It's not going to work.
That's really? Where it all ties hand in hand. You know, when we clean a record up, we want to provide facilities. And this is how we came together. This is how I came together with Southwest and some of our staff, Danny Tame, and talk with him and say, what can we do? What difference? How can we make a difference in our community? Where can we use? Let's use Southwest as our hub, bring all our other organizations together, collaborate, and let's give a day of sharing and caring with the homeless and address all their issues from mental health to financial aid to veterans, disability, everything that they need that needs to be addressed, let's address it right then and there. Let's have workshops, and then we want to give a day of sharing and caring where we can give back to our community.
Let me ask you, because we're running out of time. The drug addicted, they're going to be released under 47 as well.
Yes. Right.
Okay, because that's personal abuse. Right. All right. Have they had any side things set up for those that are addicted that are coming back? Have they set up any programs or any avenues for them to recover?
I think it needs to be addressed in the mental health aspect. I think, that, you know, not to blame too. Ronald okay. Reagan, but to blame Ronald Reagan. He's the one who let him out.
That's
so, you know, so instead of addressing the issue, you know, that's what needs to be addressed. Of course, there's a substance abuse problem, but that's at the surface. What is the root cause of it? Mm-hmm. What is the root cause of this that we need to get to this ugliness that's creating in our people? So I don't want to just, the homelessness. So
hopelessness.
I can tell you right now that root cause is decades of disinvestment. When he cut all those social service programs, then they unleashed this prison boom, and it just took off. That's what we're fighting to address and reshape and reconstruct right now. And tied to Prop 47, you know, the Board of Supervisors, they're going to be having board hearings. They want to hear from the community exactly where we want that money to go to specifically. So these are key dates coming up and key activities. And let me know when I could give a website or something where folks who want to come out and voice. So we already have folks that support. We Community Coalition supports intervention.
Can they go on,
hands
can
down.
They go on the Community Coalition website and get the information you're speaking about?
They can to a certain aspect. They
give
can.
Us a
we
website.
Have phone number. We have, I got a phone number. I got
give,
everything.
Give the website and the phone number.
Okay.
Where folks can follow up.
Well, Community Coalition's website is cocosouthla.org. That's COCOSOUTH, the letters LA and .org. And my direct line is 323-750-9087, extension 212. So any questions?
Number.
Okay. 323-750-9087, extension 212. Any questions about Prop 47, upcoming events, resource fairs, jobs? Please give me a call. This is what I do.
Yes, and also what I want to do is bring awareness. And for those that's interested in awareness or getting their felonies reduced, we need them to come out to our Day of Sharing and Caring event August the 21st and sign up, because we will be giving another big Prop 47. April the 21st from 1 to 3. Come out and sign up at Southwest College, because we're going to try to give the biggest Prop 47 awareness and reduction day.
And you're encouraging felons to come and find out that they too can qualify under Prop 47 for some things.
Right.
Not perfected for them, but there are some felons that can, felony convictions that can be.
You can go onto our website under Community Transformation Program.org and anything you need to know about Prop 47, like he said, as far as when the next event's going to be, workshops or whatever else, you can still find it at my organization, communitytransformation.org. Or you can call me at area code 323-674-4376.
Say that phone number one more time.
Area code 323-674-4376. If you have your rap sheet, I will reduce your felonies personally myself.
Heard that?
All right.
Young man, you want to say something before we go off the air?
Yes. As a student of LA Southwest College and seeing the beautiful campus and seeing how many efforts there are on campus to deal with the issues of the community, and in my process of becoming, you know, entwined, I guess, with these efforts, if you are interested in reaching out, my number is 310-720-6754. And if you're interested, or if you're attending Southwest and thinking about attending Southwest, or you're just around it, please reach out if you're interested in helping and seeing all these great efforts come to fruition.
And say that number one more time.
It is 310-720-6754.
And your name?
Chase Fredrick.
Chase. And your name?
Gilbert Johnson.
And your name?
Winnetka Vaden.
And your name, sir?
Adewole Umoja.
All right. The professor at our favorite community college. Yeah, that's right. That's all right. How are we on time?
Got long enough for the doctor to share something with us real quick. Give us
real
something.
Quick.
Okay. Well, real quick, I want to go back and talk about some immediate things that can be done.
Yes.
Because what Gilbert raised is there is an immediate issue about the money, the pot of money that can be and was designed to go to mental health, to drug rehab services. So immediately you can lobby the governor, put pressure on your local officials and elected officials to press for a reallocation of this money. This can be an immediate infusion.
But at the same time, we're going to have to organize our community to get involved with that.
Okay,
huh?
Now, what I want to follow up on. Winnetka has mentioned our program on April the 21st. Mm-hmm. Okay, but we also have a strategic vision where in October we have projected another program, a day of coming together, providing a home for the homeless, we have entitled it. Mm-hmm. A day for not only distribution of resources, but calling together a conference of stakeholders so that we can begin to formulate a strategic program to provide permanent housing for the homeless in our community.
And this is a call, an outreach. Outreach. If you've got answers, we need to hear them. If you're sitting on that secret, keeping it to yourself, you're not helping anybody. Right, and these people are here to tell you we need those resources.
That's right.
We need to be proactive in the things we believe need to be fixed. And Prop 47 and the funding under the mental health for those that are drug addicted, we need to push for that. Yeah. We do. We need to push for whatever is going to help those coming home recover and not become repeat offenders. Mm-hmm. Like Gilbert said, when he came home, there was nothing for him.
Sister, I need you to keep your head to the sky.
All right. Maurice is singing to us, huh?
We need to go.
It's so time already. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming in. We're going to post whatever we can at the Gang Talk Forum on Facebook.
April 21st, Los Angeles Southwest College.
What time?
1 p.m. to 3 p.m.
There it is.